The world is on fire, with radical Islam fanning the flames.
Enough's enough. Our police and our leaders tiptoe around this issue. This issue is political Islam. It's political Islam that's spreading across this country.
One pastor's message for the so-called religion of peace.
I am the true picture of what Islam is all about.
After his face was nearly burnt off.
I have fallen into the ambush of Muslim terrorists.
On today's 700 Club.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this edition of the 700 Club. We've got a fabulous program for you today. We've got an analysis of what's going on, the breakup of Europe, the terrible things that are happening there. We're going to talk about a woman, a young lady who was born with incurable diseases, who little by little by little was healed by God. We've got many, many exciting things. But right now, the United States is once again calling on Iran to release an American pastor jailed for his faith. Saeed Abedini is serving an 8-year prison sentence. What? For sharing the gospel inside Iran.
And Tuesday, Pastor Abedini's wife appeared before the United Nations in Geneva to plead for her husband's release. George Thomas has the story.
For 251 days, Saeed Abedini has languished inside one of the most brutal prisons in the world.
Why is he being held? Because he exercised his rights of religious freedom, expression, and peaceful assembly.
On Tuesday, his wife took her husband's case before the UN's Human Rights Council in Geneva.
I hope that my presence here today will put a face to those who suffer when a government does not uphold its obligation to protect these freedoms.
The 33-year-old Iranian-born U.S. citizen is sentenced to 8 years in prison for his Christian faith, and while in prison, has endured torture.
On at least 2 known occasions, Iran's officials have physically tortured my husband. These instances of tortures have caused my husband to have symptoms of internal bleeding.
The White House on Monday said it was deeply concerned about Pastor Abedini's plight and promised to press for his release until he was back home with his family. The U.S. State Department also chimed in.
We condemn Iran's continued violation of the universal right of freedom of religion and call on the Iranian authorities to respect Mr. Abedini's human rights and release him. We will continue to pursue this in every way that we possibly can, through every channel that we possibly can.
But Abedini is not alone. Last month, Iranian authorities shut down the largest Persian language church and arrested its pastor. With less than 2 weeks to go before Iranians pick their next president, authorities are reportedly targeting individuals and groups deemed dangerous, including growing Christian churches. Just before ending her UN speech, Nagmeh said on Facebook that she wanted to use her appearance to plant the seeds of the gospel message before a global audience.
Iran has kept Saeed's imprisonment because Saeed believes in forgiveness of sin through Jesus Christ, and that whoever accepts this forgiveness of sin can be reconciled to the God of peace and love. This is the God of peace we're all searching for.
George Thomas, CBN News.
Well, keep praying for that man. It's just shocking, the brutality that takes place in Iran. And this is what happens when the Muslims gain control. This is an Islamic state run by mullahs. Well, you know, in the Bible, it talks about somebody not being able to buy or sell without the mark of the beast. And somebody says, well, that's just old-fashioned fiction. Well, is it? Here at home, a new technology that could change the way people buy and sell is attracting a great deal of attention. Lee Webb has more on that and other news from the CBN newsroom. Here's Lee.
New technology could let you have an electronic tattoo that can store your passwords online. Motorola demonstrated the electronic tattoo at a recent technology conference. The so-called bio stamps contain flexible electronic circuits. They attach to the skin with a rubber stamp. To verify your identity, users would just place their smartphone near their tattoo. Motorola is also touting computer chip pills, if you can believe that. Once swallowed, stomach acid powers the tiny tablets, and they give off a signal that can verify your identity. Privacy advocates, however, are concerned about all of this, but a Motorola spokeswoman says the company will not be put off by people who find the technology, quote, creepy. Privacy expert Catherine Albrecht tells CBN News that technology like this could have far-reaching implications.
I have to say, as a Bible-believing Christian, that I have some real concerns about this being a mark on the skin that's actually transmitting a number that down the road could definitely be used to buy and sell and really to perform just about every other action in society.
The technology will not be available for some time, but it's in the works, Pat.
You know, the frightening thing is that with miniaturization, they can take everything about you, all of your stock accounts, all of your bank accounts, all of your insurance policies, all of your health data, all of the way you voted, all the way where you live and when you've moved and what education you have. It can all be present on that chip, just a little teeny, teeny chip. And yes, it can be inserted under the skin. They've already done that, but now they've got something that's even easier. You just, you know, it's glued on. I mean, they think that's a move forward, but it's a move backwards toward Big Brother. And it's, I'm telling you, the Bible is coming true right before our very eyes. Well, there's a shocker coming up. One of the least qualified people in the government is now going to be promoted to a very sensitive role. Here's that story.
President Obama's top national security advisor, Tom Donilon, is resigning. He'll be replaced by the U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, Susan Rice. Conservatives criticized Rice, of course, severely after she blamed the attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi, Libya, on a YouTube video. Instead, of course, it turned out to be a terrorist attack. President Obama considered nominating Susan Rice for Secretary of State. She withdrew, though, because of Republican criticism. She does not need Senate confirmation for this new position. Betrayal, fear, intimidation. Those are some of the words conservatives used in a congressional hearing to describe how they felt when dealing with the Internal Revenue Service in the last few years. The IRS targeted Tea Party and other conservative groups and held them up from getting tax-exempt status. Ephraim Graham has that story.
Some conservative groups for the first time on Capitol Hill testified about their experiences with the IRS Tuesday. One group says it waited 3 years for the IRS to approve its tax-exempt status. Another is still waiting. But they all say they were targeted because of their conservative political views.
The Wetumpka Tea Party filled out a complete application. Our organization fell within the boundaries of receiving a 501c4 status. Yet, our application was singled out solely because we had Tea Party in our name.
Nearly 3 years in waiting for an answer is totally unacceptable. The IRS needs to be fully investigated and held accountable for its incompetence, harassment, and targeting of conservative groups.
The president of the Coalition for Life of Iowa testified the IRS asked about the content of their prayers, and the IRS demanded they promise not to demonstrate outside Planned Parenthood. The National Organization for Marriage testified someone from within the IRS leaked their confidential tax documents to a gay activist group.
The copy of our tax returns and our list of donors that was posted there was redacted. Our computer forensic people were able to unlayer the redactions from that PDF file and discovered that the original document that was posted there had originated from within the IRS.
The National Organization for Marriage says that means someone at the IRS committed a felony. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
You saw Becky Gerritsen in Ephraim's report. She is the president of a Tea Party group outside of Montgomery, Alabama. She told the committee, "I'm a born free American woman. I'm telling my government you've forgotten your place." Pat, I got to tell you, that was powerful testimony yesterday.
Very powerful. The idea that the IRS is leaking documents, though, that is a federal crime. They put you in a slammer for many years for doing that. And if those officials have done it, it's serious business. But not only that, Lee, the thing that, you know, that Congressman McDermott was blow-fighting, I believe, in one of those hearings about the fact that these people were asking for the government to pick up the tab. A C-4 doesn't get any benefit at all in terms of tax reduction. Contributions to C-4s are not tax deductible. The income of a C-4 is not necessarily tax deductible, but if it is, it's from contributions, and we don't have to pay taxes if somebody gives us a gift. So the idea that the government is going to have to pay the bills for this is absurd. Now, C3, on the other hand, the people do get tax deduction for the contributions they make to charitable organizations, religious churches, and so forth. But a C4 is permitted to do lobbying and is permitted to speak out, but there's no tax deduction for the donors to C4s. So if anybody says that as a congressman, he ought to know better. Lee?
Bad new details are coming out now about IRS waste of taxpayer dollars. Senior IRS officials enjoyed luxury hotel rooms and free drinks at a $4 million training conference in Anaheim, California. They also had some dance lessons, I guess, here, if you can look at that. That's according to a report by an inspector general in the Treasury Department. The 2010 meeting was one of many expensive gatherings the agency held for employees over a three-year period. One top official even stayed in a room that cost $3,500 a night. Another stayed four nights in a room that cost nearly $1,500 a night. The IRS also spent more than $500,000 to produce three videos that we showed you there, shown at the conference. That massive tornado that hit Oklahoma Friday was the widest ever recorded. Experts say it was more than 2.5 miles wide. They've also confirmed it was a strong EF5 tornado with winds nearly 300 miles per hour. The Oklahoma Medical Examiner's Office says the death toll is now up to 19, but one expert says it could have been much worse had it hit a heavily populated area. William Hoke of the American Meteorological Society says, "You dodged a bullet. You lay that path over Oklahoma City, and you have devastation of biblical proportions." Meanwhile, Operation Blessing, still on the ground in Moore, Oklahoma, south of Oklahoma City. Over the 2 weeks they have been there, they have coordinated and sent out more than 2,500 volunteers.
What groups do we have that this is their first day coming to volunteer? Where are you guys from over here?
Mobile, Alabama.
Bless their hearts for serving like that. Teams support residents through hard work as well as prayer. Well, sunscreen is known to be one of the best defenses against skin cancer. Now researchers believe it can slow signs of aging too. A study out of Australia compared people who used sunscreen randomly and those who used it daily. After 4.5 years, the regular users had almost 25% less aging, at least on their hands. Ultraviolet rays cause damage to your skin anytime you're in the sun. Dermatologists recommend using sunscreen daily, but also limiting time outdoors during peak UV hours. That's from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Vegetarians live longer than people who eat meat. That's the finding from a new study of more than 73,000 people for nearly 6 years. Researchers from Loma Linda University in California followed members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Apparently, that's a denomination that supports a vegetarian diet. The study found 12% fewer deaths among vegetarians. Researchers also found that they had less chance of dying from heart disease, diabetes, and kidney failure. The study also pointed out that vegetarians are more likely to live a healthy lifestyle, not drinking or smoking. Science does know that plant food is good for your health, and this study is likely to be seen as more confirmation of that, Pat.
So we'll slather on sunscreen and we'll eat our veggies and be healthy and live a long
time. One can only hope, right?
That's great. Hey, I want to put in a plug for Operation Blessing. Mm-hmm. This tornado and more, you know, the thing came back again, and not the same one, but another one. We have volunteers out there, and it's committed to support the residents of that area with prayer and hard work. We have 2,500 volunteers in the 2 weeks that they were in Oklahoma, and the Disaster Relief Fund, CBN Center, Virginia Beach, Virginia. By the way, Terry, this was a 2.5 mile. It was the biggest they'd ever seen. They said if it hit Oklahoma, it would be massive devastation. There's a little town, I believe the name is Breslau, in on the border of Czechoslovakia in Germany. They had the worst flooding they'd had in over 500 years.
Oh,
so we're talking about extraordinary weather. Why, I don't know, but nevertheless, it's there. And the biggest hurricanes, the hottest temperature, the coldest temperature, and the most massive flood in central Germany, at least, I guess it's southern Germany, that they have had in 500 years. It's extraordinary.
Unpredictable. Yeah, unpredictable sure, weather patterns. Okay. But we can make a difference by helping in the aftermath. Yeah. So we thank you.
An artist whose painting was removed from an Air Force dining hall says the Pentagon is censoring Christian art. Ron DeCiani's painting is called Blessed Are the Peacemakers and references the scripture Matthew 5:9. It was part of a collection to honor the heroes who responded to the 9/11 terrorist attacks. But it was removed from Idaho's Mountain Home Air Force Base less than an hour after the Military Religious Freedom Foundation complained. That's the same organization whose leader called religious proselytizing a national security threat. The artist's son told Fox News, on its face, this seems like nothing short of a clear anti-Christian agenda. An Egyptian court has convicted 43 nonprofit workers of illegally using foreign funds to incite unrest. That includes at least 16 Americans. All but one of the Americans were sentenced in absentia. Egypt's Muslim Brotherhood government is criticized for restricting the work of independent government groups. The State Department called the court's decision incompatible with the democratic transition. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.